Well, if any of you can stand this, we'll try once again to make a breakthrough. I'm not sure I can stand it. There's a lot of strain. There's a lot of strain here, for sure. Going really fast and pushing things as much as possible, but we need to do that right now. You know, we can't live forever on the past. We cannot. We have to get it now. We can't be forever listening to Sri Nisargadatta, Ramana Maharshi, you know, etc., etc. We have to be able to realize ourselves right now, right now, right here, right now. We need success, absolutely need success, because conditions of the world have radically changed in terms of pressure. And so we're just making an all-out push right here is all we're doing. And it's justified, it's totally justified. I realize this is a lot of taping, no question about it. But every single one has been a breakthrough. It's been tremendous, and we have another one here for you. It was just triggered in me recently reading a comment, and something just triggered, and it just, oh my gosh. Essentially, how to put this? Well, first thing we do is the mood of repentance, which is this calm, sober, passive intensity, non-reactivity, non-emotiveness. We expect a breakthrough. See, expect a breakthrough. Prepare for it in your overall being of non-reactivity. You're going to take it in stride. It's all about taking great breakthroughs in stride. That's what the mood of repentance really enables us to do. We know we need a breakthrough. We have a severe continuity problem. We need a breakthrough. We need breakthroughs. We really need to make progress, great progress. We expect it. We expect to make great progress. So when it comes, we just stay in stride, okay? Just keep going. Say okay. No biggie. Just keep going. Now I can feel this breakthrough emerging. It has to do with happiness. How to approach this? Now, through doing the exercise, the continuity problem exercises, about a week ago or so, I think it was last week, it would have been Monday or something, I had this, you know, dawning of God realization as I was driving, and I just like said, wow. And it's not far away right now. It's not far away. I can feel it's not far away at all. So the mood of repentance accepts this fact, says, you know what, I'm really close to you know, major breakthrough. And so that's fine. That's fine. Then you just normalize it and say, okay, that's where I am. Those who are in the mood of repentance expect success. Absolutely expect success. Those who are all trying to party and stuff, they don't believe they can have any real success at all. So they're just trying to, you know, distract themselves from their failure. But if you really expect success, you know you're gonna get it. You're gonna be very serious and just say, oh, okay, I expect it. I'm gonna wait here calmly and I'm gonna get it. So, had this breakthrough and had it one more time last week, a couple times last week, and it feels close, very, very close, feels very close. Now, got to be careful at this point. Uh, I'm not sure what to do. You just let it be. Try to grasp it. Let it be. What do you do at this point? You just feel it's very, very close. Well, we just have to see how this video goes. That's all. I don't know how it's gonna go. We could say I don't have a closeness problem. I have a continuity problem. And realize, look, whatever the insight is, whatever it is, we're going to need to abide in it for quite some time. And so just take it in stride. It's like medicine. Let's say you need to take medicine for every day for the rest of your life because you have some, you know, problem. It's like that. We will need to abide in this for every day for the rest of our lives. We'll need to be on this medicine, the spiritual medicine. So maybe we can look at that first, because that's sort of a problem. Like, I think, no, maybe I just take it a couple times and I'm cured. No, the continuity problem we have isn't going to be cured for like that. We're going to need to take this every day for the rest of our lives. And so many of us say, oh boy, that's too much, too much, too much. So I'm kind of looking at it. I'm seeing it's right there. It's right there. What do you do? What do you do? Maybe just chat. Maybe just talk. Maybe just continue the exercises. But be cautious. Be cautious. Be cautious. If you feel it's starting to fade, then whatever you're doing, just kind of drop it and just, you know, don't push it away. Maybe there's lots of ways you can push your insight away, but don't push it away. And can it even be explained? Can it be explained? Or can it only be entered into? Well, I gotta be careful there, not to try to put words onto it. So this is an example. A lot of times you have to be cautious. Be cautious. Don't try to go too fast. So in this case, I'll just say, well, I know there's this huge breakthrough. I know I'm on the brink of this huge breakthrough. So just look at that. Instead of trying to get the breakthrough, just say, oh, okay, I'm on the brink of just an absolutely huge breakthrough. How does that feel? How does that feel? So you can do that when you feel you have a breakthrough. Say, okay, I'm just right here, very near, and I realize that this is going to happen. Put myself in position for that to happen. So how do we get to this point? Well, you say, well, we put ourselves in a position for this to happen. We did the work. We did the work. We wouldn't be here if we didn't do the work. That's the way to look at it. When you approach a great breakthrough, say, well, I did all the work. I've done the work. And the work has been done, so there's nothing to worry about. And I expect this. And focus on how much work you've done to get to this point. It's not just coming out of the blue, it's coming out from the totality of all your efforts to move your comfort zone. So you've moved your comfort zone up to this point. So there's probably no point in trying to jump out of your comfort zone. Just continue to stay in it and continue to move it. Continue to move it. Because again, we'll have to be staying in whatever great realization we have. We're going to have to be, you know, abiding in that for quite some time. oftentimes people want answers. They want answers. They want breakthroughs. But prior to the breakthrough, you actually have to have a comfort zone with being close to the breakthrough. Even though you're very close, you have to still say, okay, I'm now very close. And get used to that. Get used to being very close. I was watching some videos on YouTube, and I found that they just really did not, they don't have it. They don't capture this. They don't. It just doesn't. It just doesn't. Much of the spiritual teaching over the last 50 some years, it doesn't capture this, does not really get it. We've kind of watered it down, actually. We kind of psychologized it too much. We intellectualized it too much. We came at it from an academic standpoint. So we're, as a culture, we're not really ready. We're not really ready as a culture for the kind of breakthrough that I'm seeing is right there. So I believe that it's very important when you get close to a breakthrough that you accept the fact that others won't understand and really won't accept it, and it's going to be, you're just going to have to be calm with it and just accept that it's like, you know, you can't just go running out in the street and yelling, hey, oh my gosh, I just discovered the greatest breakthrough and it's possible, you know. And no, it doesn't work that way. So you have to be able to accept it for yourself, and don't expect other people to embrace it, understand it, anything like that. So this is a very sobering kind of realization, very sobering, because I don't see much understanding of it, really. And then that gets us to try to tailor it so that others will accept it, and then you lose it. You lose it. Everybody is looking for, how does it relate to me? How does this relate to me? The fact is, from what I see the breakthrough, it doesn't relate to me. It doesn't relate to me. It relates to the totality. You might say it relates to all me's, without exception. The universe, reality, is totally relative. It relates to all, without exception. All are included in the oneness. It's not like you realize, like, hey, I am included in the oneness, and then therefore I'm happy. This is my happiness. That's not the realization. The realization is that all are included in the oneness. All are included in the pure spaciousness. All are totally eternal. This is an eternal condition of everything. That's the realization. Now, is that a personal happiness? Like, I am happy. It's hard to say that exactly, you know? You could say that you're in bliss, or you're experiencing this universal happiness. That's not a concern. But it's not a discovery that you are in God. It's a discovery that everything is. That there's forever. And that you are living in a completely sacred realm, as is everybody else. So it's more of a total happiness. It's not your happiness, it's everyone's happiness. It's that there's only happiness. There's only this happy fact. It's a fact. And somehow we've had trouble with this. There's no question about it. But these practices that have been suggested to me, and I've been trying, actually, no question, they work. They work, and they bring you right to it, right to it. Amazing. Right to this realization. And so, of course, you have to be. You know, part of the thing is dealing with success is very difficult. It's easy to fail. We're used to failing. But when you start to succeed, then you say, wow, I've been brought right to success, right to the door here. And then you have to accept this fact that you're going to succeed. And that you're seeing everybody is, everything is eternal life. Already. And we are all dwelling, surrounded by eternal life and perfect happiness, perfect futures for everything. It's not just your good fortune, it's everyone's good fortune. You're astonished at the good fortune for all. Complete lack of misfortune. Now, are we ready for such a realization? Has our school, has our culture prepared us for such a realization? So, you know, it's what can you do? What can you do? definitely, we're not prepared as a culture, a society, etc. But what can you do? When it's your time, it's your time. So it's almost like you have to resign yourself to it. You know, it's my time to take the medicine, that's all. Look at it as medicine. Try to look at it that way. Yeah, I got it. It's my time to take the cure. You know, others, they're not yet. So it's really kind of a stressful situation. But what helps out is at least I know that there are this technique, the continuity problem technique, that those who really are interested can practice this. I don't have to try to explain it, because it's useless to explain if you're not going to practice. It's just, you're not going to get there. You have to take the, deflate all the projections, all the psychic projections need to be deflated first. Have to understand all this because the way the world reacts to this is through, you know, they're still bound by all their problems with projection. Don't recognize there's a continuity problem. So those two situations, you know, that the four pillars of failure are most people are trapped by those. So it won't be grasped. You cannot grasp it that way. You cannot get to it that way. But these exercises, for those who want to get there, I'm seeing they're extremely effective. So I certainly can at least relate to the world through those exercises, saying, here, you know, let's work on these exercises. And that'll have so there's a middle ground, a meeting ground there, right, between those who don't have the realization yet and those who do. The right spiritual practice provides the meeting ground for that to happen. So that's how I'm looking at it. Vision of oneness does. It's you know, the essence of what's profound, really. So, I take heart in that there is this meeting ground, this technique, the continuity problem. I feel that's a fabulous right spiritual practice, and from this can be a whole body of right spiritual practice that can enable just a tremendous effectiveness to take place, built on the mood of repentance, which is this attitude when you want to meet someone who has the vision of oneness. You have to have this attitude of mood of repentance, non-emotive, non-demonstrative, humble, honest. I have a huge problem. You come and say, I have a huge problem. Absolutely, that is true. Searching for individual happiness is a huge problem, that is for sure. Not being able to wake from this dream of projection is a huge problem. Continuity problem is this vast block problem. So the mood of repentance has to be there, because you're really saying, I believe that I'm going to have breakthroughs here. I want to have breakthroughs. What other reason would you ever go to someone who has had the breakthroughs, you know, necessary breakthroughs? You want to have the breakthroughs. So you have to have the right attitude to take those in stride. Just take it in stride. Say, okay, I had that breakthrough, okay. That's what happens in these traditions of spirit, right spiritual practice. You know, the people are very humble, very low-key, very calm, non-demonstrative, etc. And they just calmly sit there. And over the years, or while they're practicing, they have all these breakthroughs. And they really don't say much about them. They might say a little bit. But stay very humble, very serious, very humble. That's what actually works. That's what actually works. So that's the first thing that has to happen. to withstand the impact of these breakthroughs, you have to have this certain kind of attitude, and this can be cultivated, developed, worked on. You have to keep working on it. No matter where you are, you have to keep working on it. It's called dispassion. You know, there's a term, dispassion. Detached, dispassion, but it's more than that. It's a determination that you're going to remain calm through this breakthrough process. And I've been practicing this for a long time. I got started with A Course in Miracles in 1978. I'd done a lot of work before then. And I just had to train myself to just, you know, read, and just, wow, stop for a while, let it calm down, don't react, don't try to latch onto anything. I just would look, sort of diffuse, my perception was just diffuse. I'm not looking at anything in particular, sort of a blank stare out into space, not in trying to engage the world in any way, just watching the mind, making sure it doesn't start trying to generate some storyline, emotional storyline. So actually I've been practicing this, you know, for most of my life. And I think that those who want to have success need to do that. You really need to challenge yourself every day and remain dispassionate in your clarifications and understandings, because you'll get some breakthroughs every day if you're really pushing it. One of the tricks you can do is you say, well, yeah, I'm kind of entering into something good, but it's not supreme success because I have to take it every day. It's a medicine. It's more of a medicine than success. It's more of a you know, resolving it through abiding in it than success. We're not claiming any ultimate success here. That takes a lot of the pressure off. Because how do we relate to ultimate success here in this world? That's very difficult. So I wouldn't recommend that too much. They say Zen tradition, carry water and chop wood. After you've realized your true nature, you just continue on, because you have to abide in that now. Everyday abidance in it. It's another challenge there. It's another challenge. What it is that you realize happiness is inescapable. It's universal, completely universal. There's nowhere where it isn't. Total happiness, always, everywhere it is. And so, all the events taking place make no difference. You're going to be experiencing this richness all the time. Now, most of us prefer to talk about others who have experienced this and comment on it rather than actually experiencing ourselves, because it seems But again, we have a continuity problem. So we can fall back on that. This is what I'm seeing. We can fall back on that and say, well, I'm doing it because I have to cure this continuity problem. Otherwise, I will continue to suffer incredible misery. So I have to stay in this happiness all the time. It's part of the cure. It's just part of the cure. It's a different way of looking at it. I feel this takes the pressure off of us. You don't want to get up and say, you know, everybody, I'm totally spiritually enlightened. I have God realization, and I'm intoxicated with God realization, and I'm the great master and the guru and all this kind of stuff. You know, who wants to do that, you know, right off the bat? Who wants to do that? No. Not in today's society, are you kidding? They don't want to do that. So it's more like you say, okay, I'm a really poor sinner. You know, I got a gigantic, severe, intensely severe and vast continuity problem. I've completely forgotten what reality is like, and this is just the first, some medicine I have to drink. You know, I have to drink it. Yeah, sure, it's blissful and happy, but it's a strain. I got to do it. Don't really want to do it that much, but I got to do it. I mean, I really have to do it. I have to be perfectly happy every day. I got no choice. Look at it that way. Look at it that way. I said, I wouldn't have to be doing this if I didn't have such a terrible problem. But I do. I really have a terrible problem. And in fact, the fact is, I do. Absolutely all do. I just realized it. But certainly, this fear of the continuity issue pushes you down into highways and byways that you don't want to go down. That is for sure. Very, very bad avenues in this world. Just horrible. Easy to find yourself in a situation that you just absolutely don't want to be in. It's amazing. It's amazing that our psychic projections, that the pressure they put on us to get in worse and worse and worse situations. It's just appalling, actually. What I've been through is absolutely appalling. And couldn't stop it. You know, it's just horrible. You end up being like a slave to these psychic projections and becoming a nothing, disposable nothing. So, got a severe problem. We have a very drastic problem. We need to take the medicine, and this is simply the medicine that we're taking. Other people take antidepressants. We take this vision of oneness, that's all. You know, downplay it. To a certain extent, now, gradually as you get more and more used to it, more and more used to it, more and more used to it, you may downplay it to a lesser extent and gradually, you know, go that way is would think that's probably the way it goes. I'm noticing that in the world right now, there is a vast downplaying of this whole situation. It's amazing how many spiritual teachers have kind of disappeared or just such low profile now. It didn't used to be that way, but it is now. So it seems like the low profile at this point is what's happening. Is what's happening. So probably just have somewhat of a low profile. Just taking our medicine. People say, "Are you some sort of spiritual master?" I'm a you know, very poor spirit, poor sinner. I mean, I have this drastic problem. I'm in therapy. I'm in medication. I'm having, you know, spiritual chemotherapy. Actually, having spiritual Holy Spirit chemotherapy for my spiritual problem. So, that's all I'm doing. So how do you downplay it? How do you downplay it? I was at church today and I wasn't really singing at all, hardly. You know, I was downplaying it. I was in the mood of downplaying it all. I was like just singing really terrible. See, I didn't want to draw any attention to myself, so I just, it doesn't seem in the world right now we're at a time when playing it up big seems to be what's happening right now. You know, that could always change at some point, but downplaying it may be the way to go. That's an option. But keep in mind, we have this problem. It's not gone. Just because we have the vision of oneness, just like when we turn off the fan hasn't stopped yet. It's still circulating air, pushing air around, right? There's still some turmoil in the room. But you know, eventually it'll everything will calm down. So you just abide in that. Let it calm down, let it calm down, let everything just normalize and calm down. But yeah, it's amazing what's happened in the world. How it seems like that spiritual enlightenment, all that stuff, has just kind of like vanished. And you listen to those who you think are they enlightened or not? They seem, maybe they're indicating they might be, you know. And you say, wow, you know, that's, I don't quite think so. Are they just downplaying it, or what's happened here in the world? What has happened? Maybe they succumbed to the pressure, you know. It's possible. Very interesting time right now. But definitely inside of me, there's all this kind of, things are jumping around. It's like, because I know I'm not far off, that is for sure. And if I keep doing these exercises, I'm probably going to, It's going to happen for me. You know, anyone who does these exercises intensely, the way I'm doing them, it's going to happen for them for sure. For sure. You start talking about the unmanifest, and then you're getting real close. I don't know how close I am, but it's just, you know, that's, and no reason to try and, you know, measure anything. But no question, the progression of these practices has been so rapid and so profound. You just know that you're headed into the, you know, headed to the finish line. So. This table is the perfect unmanifestness. Is the perfection of the unmanifest. You can say that to all things. You can say that this bottle is the perfection of the unmanifest. Something like that. You can work on the practice yourself. You can come up with your own statements, you know. Don't have to follow a book exactly. And you can just, you can say, okay, let's drop that. Sort of like composing a song, or throwing, you know, just, you get it so it sounds right, speed back to you sounds just right. And the practice, it works. It works. This plant, as it is eternal. It's totally eternal. This room, as it is totally eternal. This chair, as it is, is totally eternal. This window, as it is totally eternal. So you just practice wherever you are, and just everything that you're seeing, all these things, use them and say, this desk, as it is totally eternal. This desk as it is the heart of eternal presence. Is the very heart of eternal presence. This bookshelf as it is the very heart of eternal presence. Because there's only this eternal presence. But we need to practice with things because that is what is holding us back. So, in other words, be specific with things. This sofa, as it is the heart of eternal presence. This air, as it is the heart of eternal presence. This plant as it is totally unbounded eternal presence, totally unbounded eternal life. Eternal life is centered as this plant. Eternal life is centered as this wall. Eternal life is centered as this desk. Eternal life is centered as this book. Eternal life is centered as this computer. This computer is central to eternal life. This bookshelf is central to eternal life. This light is central to eternal life. This window is centered, is the center of eternal life, is the center. You see, eternal life is this, everywhere is the center. Everywhere is the center. I am always in the center. This body is always in the center of eternal life. This plant is always in the center of eternal life. This table is always in the center of eternal life. Now, none of these statements quite get it. So you get this feeling like, I don't quite get it. That's okay. Stay calm. There is complete appreciation here and now. This table is complete appreciation. This desk is complete appreciation. This space is complete appreciation. There is only complete appreciation without a second. So you keep chipping away, You have to, use, you know, I find it's useful to try and come up with your own words. Anybody can just follow a textbook or something and say what's in there. This appreciation is here now. Appreciation of the eternal is here now. Appreciation of now is now. There you go. Appreciation of now is now. Appreciation is appreciation. The vastness without another. Vastness without another. This without another. Just this, without another, without any addition or subtraction, as it is. So just kind of trust that you're sort of sanding away the resistance, you know, like some sandpaper, just a bit at a time like that. And eventually, you know, you sand it down. Universal appreciation. Universal appreciation. Universal recognition. We're all struggling for recognition, right? And it never seems to be enough, because what our true condition is universal recognition. We are universally recognized, just as we are. This plant is universally recognized. This plant here is, as it is universally recognized. There we go. This feels like a fruitful path. We're all struggling for recognition, aren't we? Absolutely we are. So we state, this wall, is universally recognized. As it is, this wall, as it is universally recognized. It's universally loved, actually. It is. But recognition is love, right? I mean, well, the worst thing of all is just don't recognize anyone, so to speak. Although, in this world, you don't want to be distracted either by what's going on. So it's a slightly different issue. But this couch as it is, is universally recognized. Universally recognized. Vast. Totally vast recognition for this couch. This table as it is universally recognized, universally appreciated, universally supported, as it is universally recognized. This door, as it is universally recognized. Just as it is, this door, as it is universally acclaimed, universally recognized, totally, completely and universally recognized, optimally recognized. I am just as I am. I am optimally recognized, optimally, universally recognized. I am experiencing optimal recognition. This plant, as it is released into optimal recognition. This room, as it is released into optimal recognition. This sky, just as it is released into optimal recognition. This world, just as it is released in the now of optimal recognition. This world as it is dwells in the now of optimal recognition, just as it is. It abides. This world as it is abides in the realm of optimal recognition, just as it is. This world is released in as optimal recognition. Everyone on this planet, just as they are optimally recognized. In this moment, all are released as this optimal recognition. All are released as this optimal recognition. As this optimal recognition. Not as just like a personal, as optimal recognition. There's a slight perceptual shift that has to take place. And once it does, suddenly you get it. And if it doesn't, you don't quite get it. You just don't quite get it. That's okay. Keep trying. It will come. This day, just as it is, this day, just as it is optimally recognized. Is eternally one. This day, just as it is eternally one. One in eternal recognition, is eternally recognized. So we keep on trying, we keep on trying, we keep on trying. This plant as it is optimally recognizes everything, gives optimal recognition. This table as it is gives optimal recognition. Everything just as it is gives optimal recognition. This planet as it is optimally recognizes the entire universe. This planet, just as it is, optimally recognizes the entire universe. But recognition is recognition. Recognition is recognition. Being is being. This plant is being. This table is being. There is only being. There is only one being. There is only being. So what we're doing here is we're moving our comfort zone, not actually making the breakthrough, moving our comfort zone. This is what real practice does, right spiritual practice, intense, extreme right spiritual practice. Moving our comfort zone into this language of clarity where we're getting comfortable with this new perspective, at least on a verbal, conceptual, and other levels of reverberation, where we're saying that this is something that's feeling more and more normal and comfortable to me. That's what practice does. Don't worry if there isn't some ultimate breakthrough. that's not the point. You just keep moving your comfort zone, and that the results will take care of themselves at some point. And don't force it. Don't force it. If you're quiet, just be quiet. Just stay with this intense mood of repentance. Don't give up. But if there's nothing that comes up to say, just you don't need to say anything. You don't need to start quoting some spiritual teacher just to, you know, keep saying, I gotta keep going, I gotta keep going. No. Just stay. Let everything just reverberate. Smooth out. You can say, this is all completely unmanifest. I dwell in the unmanifest. This, as it is unmanifest. Nothing is ever manifested. We are free of manifestation. There's only the one, as the one. There's only eternal life. There's nothing to manifest. This day as it is unmanifest. This planet as it is unmanifest. This universe as it is unmanifest. as it is, as it is, as it is, as it is. This is as it is. This is as it is. This is as it is. Don't be in a race with anybody. You're simply moving your comfort zone. Just stay within your own. Be aware of your own reverberation and feeling. And move your comfort zone. Move your comfort zone. You're not in a race with anybody. Nobody's in a race. There are no deadlines. From an absolute standpoint. There is no race. Everything as it is has finished. This plant, as it is, has no deadlines. It's deadline free. This day as it is deadline free. This moment as it is deadline free. This world as it is deadline free. Nothing has ever happened. This plant as it is has never happened. This plant is happening free. It's free of happening. As it is free of happening. This desk is free of any happening. As it is free of happening. But keep using this language, keep using this language, keep using this language like this. Wears away, you know, the resistance, it wears it away. And there really is no other remedy other than this exertion. You know, you have to do it. It's like a job that has to be done, medicine that has to be taken. I know we all look for some magical route, and we may spend our whole lives doing that and never practice. But the real secret is just to actually do this, even though we can't quite understand, you know, well, why is it effective, but it is. And so it's just all a matter of actually getting down and just, you know, going to work, it's all. People think the guru is going to help them avoid the work, just the opposite. Basically, the guru will say, look, wherever you are, sit down and just go to work on this. Start wearing away the resistance. Start wearing it away. This plant is, as it is eternally liberated, is eternally free. This day, as it is eternally liberated, is eternally free. We get used to saying less and less and less and less and less. Because what I saw in this dawning of God realization is that really, at that point, words don't suffice at all. They don't suffice at all. So what we're doing is we're limiting our verbal conceptual expressions to this very, you know, small, now is now, is, just is, one word, is. Getting used to that, so we're comfortable with that, and we realize we can still function fine without, you know, all complex expressions and explanations, etc. We can still do it if we want to, but we're getting used to experiencing something where we really don't need to say anything at all about it. And ultimately, as we experience the richness, there is no way to express that richness. That is the richness, you know. There's no symbol that is the richness. The richness is the richness. So symbols utterly fail to hold the water. It's like a pitcher of a cup fails to hold the water that an actual cup holds. So this technique is effective on many levels. Getting used to just very minimal speech. Now is now. This moment as it is now. See, it kind of brings it to an end, doesn't it? It brings the explanation just to an end. Quickly. Now is now. Now is now. This is this. This is this. That's it, right? You said it all. You said it all right there. You just said it all. That's all that needs to be said. This is this. So the experience you're having is the experience you're having. And so there, you know, there's no other way but to get used to this, get used to it, get used to it, get used to it, get used to it, get comfortable with it, get comfortable. I remember in the stoner times of the hippie times, these hippies would, you know, stoners would be sitting around in a circle, nobody would be saying anything, you know, and they'd look at each other, and for themselves, what they were experiencing, they couldn't really explain or express well. They'd look at someone else and they know, and they kind of nod, they say, I can't explain it either, and everybody kind of look and sort of nod, just. Nobody even bothered to try to explain it. But in this world, we demand explanations, rational, empirical explanations. What are you experiencing? How can it be turned into a product that can be sold? How can it be profitable? We're trained to say, how can this be profitable? How can we copyright it? How can we get a monopoly on it? How can we distribute this? All this stuff, right? So, this is what we're trained on. We don't realize that we have been trained to such an extreme extent to be able to wrap, package it, and make the packaging better than what it is, right? And the words are the packaging of it. Because really, you know, we buy. We're in this consumer society. We don't realize how enmeshed we are in it. And packaging is really the key to it. I mean, right? The way that everything is packaged is gives you this sense of, wow, this is really something. It's how it's sold, is the packaging is very important. The labeling, marketing, so we automatically think, how do I label, how do I package, how do I market, you know, how do I get people to buy this and all this stuff. We have this business mentality, commerce mentality, all of this stuff. And it's very, very severe, actually, especially in the West, but it's a global problem. It's a global problem. We have to get free of that. We have to get free of it. It's like saying, how do you package oneness? You know, how do you package eternal life? How do you copyright it? These are ridiculous concepts we have, and ruinous concepts for our happiness, for happiness. How do we package happiness and sell it in a soda, you know, soda? The slogans of these products that I'm seeing, you just look at it and say, wow. The advertisers are actually using like spiritual slogans to sell their soft drinks and various stuff. You like real heavy spiritual, you know, slogans, very, very profound stuff. And then saying that this product delivers this, you know. That's what they're doing now. That is what they're doing. You just pay attention. So that is effrontery on a grotesque level, really. That's chutzpah. To just a pathetic extent, actually. There's certain kind of nerve, you know, to do that, it's actually totally pathetic. And we live in a pathetic society, actually, very pathetic. And that's a difficult thing. When you realize your society is pathetic, that's hard to take. You know, kind of like you're tinged by that, right? So, people have learned to equate this lack of communicating what you're experiencing with drug use. Okay, that's another pathetic thing. They say, "Oh well, you're having some this real heavy trip. It must be on drugs because you can't explain it, and that's not useful to society. You need to be able to package it, present it. Say, okay, here's a product. What are we going to do with it? You know, it's just this whole mentality." So we do have to practice this, practice maybe more than others in the past had to practice it. We really have to practice it. This is not a joke. We don't live in the kind of society of you know, the Tibetan, Himalayan, Tibet, you know, situation 500 years ago, or India 1,000 years ago, or whatever. We don't live in that situation anymore. We don't. So we can't get away with you know, non-intense spiritual practice. We can't get away with it. We're going to fail. We're going to really, really get turned away. So we're in a situation where we literally have to work harder, I think. Work harder at it, no question about it. And so we can't quite use the things of the past now. I think we are under more pressure and duress, and have to come up with more intense effort than they did in the past right now. We have to really ace the test. You know, we really have to be very clear about it. Any lack of clarity on our part is going to get exploited at this point. What I've seen in the past is a certain laxness, and I say, "Wow!" In today's age, that would get exploited easily, but back then it did not so much. So we're in a situation where we have to be very, very clear, spot on clear. You cannot be lazy. You cannot be making mistakes. For sure, you're going to be picked off, and you're going to be. I mean, there's no stone unturned in this world right now as far as how to exploit everything that's going on. This world is totally exploitive. just, I notice just the tiniest little opening you give someone, pow, they pounce, they just pounce. Pounce on you. So we really have to be very immaculate and just absolutely nail it, you know, just get it just spot on. And this continuity technique that's come up, I feel it is, again, just incredibly powerful. Incredibly powerful. And enables you to just nail it, absolutely nail it. So we'll continue on with that. Continue on with that. And again, whoever has a vision of oneness, they will certainly know that, you know, practice for everybody here. Absolutely. And you have to really work at it now. You cannot just be a, you know, dilettante. It's not like the past, folks. This is the times that the times, when the times get tough, the tough get going. And we are in extremely, extremely tough times right now. But when the tough get going, they really get going, don't they? That's for sure. That's for sure. So it's a great opportunity, actually, for us. Great, great, great opportunity when the pressure's on. I mean, there's some like baseball players, they love the pressure. The greater the pressure, that's when they really, really come through. You know, because they say, wow, okay, I'm going to have to bear down 100% here. No mistakes. You know, got to be totally spot on. And so they rise to the occasion. So we have to come through at this time. We have to be spot on. We have to have the technique that the ego cannot defeat, and we've got it. For me, this continuity problem technique trumps the ego. It trumps the ego, absolutely. Okay, very great. You see, we've just spent some time moving our comfort zone very, very close. The dawn is just, I can tell the dawn is coming. And, but that's fine. Everything's fine. All right. All right. That's it.